Hey, this is Dr. K from my medical school, and today we're going to talk about coagulation disorders. So really, how to interpret coagulation studies. Now generally we get coagulation studies on patients who have bleeding diastases. That's a word basically that means they have a tendency to bleed. So these aren't your people who have undergone a trauma or where there's some other source for their bleeding. These are patients who may have underlying disorders, genetic disorders, acquired disorders that may prevent their blood from clotting as well as the normal person. So we're gonna go talk about how to evaluate these people and then how to interpret the studies and kind of what your stepwise approach should be. Let's first talk about the coagulation cascade. There's a previous video on the coagulation cascade, which you can refer to kind of understand the details about it. But briefly, our coagulation cascade consists of an extrinsic, intrinsic, and common pathway. The extrinsic portion consists of factors 7, tissue factor, and it's started off or sparked by tissue damage, leading to activation of tissue factor and factor 7. Now, our intrinsic pathway consists of factors 12, 11, 9, 8, and high molecular weight kininogen. Now, all these pathways feed into factor 10, which then feeds into the common pathway, which involves fibrinogen, prothrombin, thrombin, and fibrin. Our extrinsic pathway is measured with PT, our intrinsic pathway is measured with PTT, and the common pathway is measured with the INR. But the INR can also capture any abnormalities that occur in the extrinsic pathway as well. Now, this is a brief review of the coagulation pathway, as well as the labs that measure each portion of the pathway. So how do we evaluate bleeding disorders? So remember that in this discussion, we're talking about patients who have an underlying cause for their bleeding. It's not just a trauma that's caused their bleeding. So to evaluate patients with bleeding disorders, the three main tests you get are a platelet count, a PTT, and a PT. So a platelet count automatically assesses the amount of platelets you have. Now, you always want to know that because bleeding can commonly occur if someone is thrombocytopenic, meaning they have low platelets. In addition, we get a PTT to measure our intrinsic pathway and our PT to measure our extrinsic pathway. Let's take an example of a bleeding problem. So here we have our basic coagulation pathway. In this case, our PT is normal, our PTT is normal, and our INR is normal, but the patient's bleeding. So what could be causing this? Well, you first want to obtain a bleeding time. If all your coags are normal and there's no obvious disorder, attain a bleeding time. And what does the bleeding time show? Well, a bleeding time measures the interaction of platelets with the vessel wall. So if your coags are normal and the patient's bleeding, then it must be an interaction of the platelets itself. So you get a bleeding time to measure that interaction. Now, if the bleeding time is prolonged, then you have to think of one would be thrombocytopenia. So your initial test of obtaining platelets, well, that would kind of tell you right away you have thrombocytopenia. But otherwise, you could have qualitative platelet disorders, so dysfunctions within the platelets. And examples of this could be von Willebrand disease. So von Willebrand disease is one of the most common genetic causes of bleeding disorders. It could be Bernard-Soulier syndrome, where there's a defect in the glycoprotein 1B on the platelet. Glanzmann thrombocythemia was also a defect in GP, glycoprotein 2B3A. So these are all things that could occur, and these would be qualitative or low platelets that cause this normal coags with bleeding and increased bleeding time. Let's go to our second scenario. In our second scenario, our PT is absolutely normal, our PTT is elevated, and our INR is normal. So right away you can see that this is likely an intrinsic problem. So this is a problem in the intrinsic pathway. So remember, the factors involved in the intrinsic pathway include 12, 11, 9, and 8. The diseases that can affect these factors include von Willebrand disease, hemophilia A and B, and heparin therapy can cause this pattern of coags. Now, von Willebrand disease, it's the most common inherited bleeding disorder. You can get a concurrent factor 8 deficiency. So we talked about von Willebrand disease previously in our first scenario, but it also can present with this pattern of coags. The reason why is factor 8 needs to bind von Willebrand factor to remain stable. If factor 8 doesn't, it becomes unstable and degrades in circulation. So if there's not adequate amount of von Willebrand factor, an appropriate von Willebrand factor, then factor 8 can't bind to it, remains unstable, and becomes deficient in the blood. addition, what's really important to note is that in von Willebrand disease, you have mucocutaneous bleeding. That means bleeding from the oral, the nasal, the GI, and GU mucosa. This is a really important point because this may separate from other bleeding disorders. So that's von Willebrand disease. Hemophilia A and B is deficiency in factors 8 and 9. They're X-linked recessive disorders, and they cause deep tissue and joint bleeding. So the pattern of bleeding will help differentiate between hemophilia A and B and von Willebrand disease. Von Willebrand, mucocutaneous, hemophilia, deep tissue and joint. Also, heparin therapy can prolong the PTT because of its effects on these factors. And we actually monitor heparin therapy with PTT within the hospital. So those are kind of brief review of the intrinsic problems. Let's move on to our next scenario. So in our next scenario, we have a PTT that's normal, a PT that's elevated, and an INR that's elevated. This pattern of coags is consistent with an extrinsic problem. So our extrinsic problem could be due to warfarin anticoagulation, chronic liver disease, vitamin K deficiency. And in rare cases, can be a congenital factor 7 deficiency or acquired factor 7 inhibitor. Looking at the extrinsic pathway and problems, we know the factors involved in extrinsic pathway include factor 7 and tissue factor. Also in the common pathway, we have factor 10. When you have any type of vitamin deficiency or vitamin K deficiency specifically, the factors 2, 7, 9, and 10 are in decreased supply, because they require vitamin K to be produced. Coumadin acts as a vitamin K antagonist, meaning it prevents the utilization of vitamin K for the production of these factors. That's why it keeps you anticoagulated. And then chronic liver disease, if you don't have the cells to make these factors and utilize vitamin K, you can't create the factors and you develop the same problem. So all these three problems, warfarin anticoagulation, chronic liver disease, and vitamin K deficiency, have all a common etiology. Now, the utilization of vitamin K or the lack of production of these factors is what causes the extrinsic problem. In addition, you can have rare cases of congenital factor 7 deficiency and acquired factor 7 inhibitor, but it's extremely rare. Let's go on to the next scenario. In our next scenario, we have a PT that's elevated, a PTT that's elevated, and an INR that's elevated. So what's the problem? Well, it's likely a common pathway problem. If we have this pattern of coags and we think it's a common pathway problem, we measure what's called a thrombin time. This measures the conversion of fibrinogen to fibrin. If the thrombin time is normal, then areas where we could be having a deficiency include in prothrombin, in factor 5 deficiency, factor 10 deficiency, we could have liver disease, and we could have DIC, otherwise known as a disseminated intravascular coagulation. Look up DIC in our previous videos to kind of understand a little bit more about it. If your thrombin time is elevated, then possible causes include fibrinogen deficiency, factor 13 deficiency, and heparin. Now let's talk about mixing studies. You've done all your coags, there think could be a factor deficiency or inhibitor, and you want to figure it out. So you do a mixing study is the next step. In a mixing study, you mix your patient's plasma with that of normal plasma from some other source. When you mix these two together, you see the effects on the coag studies. So if you do this and the PT-PTT corrects, then you know that this is a factor deficiency because a normal plasma has provided you the factor to correct coags. But if it hasn't, the PTT and PTT remain elevated, then you have a factor inhibitor because the inhibitor in your patient's plasma is still inhibiting the factors in the normal plasma. And that can help you differentiate between a deficiency and inhibitor. Just a brief review of coags. If you like this video, make sure to share this on Facebook. Give it a like and place some comments down below, either questions, suggestions for future videos, or whatever. Make sure to subscribe, check out our podcast at iMedicalSchool, and also follow us on Twitter at iMedSchool as well. This is Dr. K from iMedicalSchool, and I'll see you next time.